Short video clip on a reforestation project.
We are here at the Cinnamon Rainforest site, near Singaraja Rainforest. This is a ecological rainforest site which we are going to reforest with the partnership of the Rukrakagannu and the Forest Department. So the funding is coming from the John Keats Foundation and the Cinnamon Hotels and Resorts. Our objective is to restore degraded land into a natural rainforest by using the native land which will be found in the near vicinity. So this will be done very scientifically with the team of scientists and also with the local people near Singaraja. So it will be multi-partnership project, so that we need to learn a lesson in terms of the reforesting degraded land as well as how to do it very, very scientifically. So we'll disseminate all this information for people to learn in terms of the how to restore wet zone forest. Our ultimate objective is to see this area converted into a natural forest maybe 20, 30 years down the road. We will take care of this land for 5 years so that we will let it go to the natural. Nature will take it over from there so that it'll be a natural habitat for all the species that are hanging around in this area to use this as an oasis land.
I'm Dushi Pereira, president of Rukrakagannu, and I'm here today at Suduveli Potha at the formal opening of our ecological reforestation project. We are indeed delighted to have John Keats Holdings and the foundation funding us, which was a dream of our former president, Mrs. Vitarna. She was the architect of this project, and now we are seeing the initial stages of her dream bearing fruit. So we were happy to have both her children here, Ranil and Manika, at the opening, along with the hierarchy of John Keats Holdings. It is a 4-year project, but cut down to 3 because of the COVID pandemic. It is a complex project because it's ecological restoration, but we have had all the partners to make it a success, it seems to be doing.
So once again, a very warm welcome from a sultry, overcast evening in Colombo. I'm Dushi Pereira from Rukrakagannu, and we are meeting today which is one of our programs of our tree talks, to give appreciation and tribute to one of our life members who are really a founder life member, Barbara Sansoni. And we have today a renowned chartered architect, Anjalendran, making this tribute and the presentation. And of course, her granddaughter. So the slides which you would have witnessed just before I spoke was partly about Rukrakagannu and what we have done. And the video clip was what we are doing presently, ecological forest reforestation in a place called Suduveli Potha, which is in the buffer zone of Singaraja. This tree talk was initiated by our evergreen secretary, Professor Shirani Balasuriya. She is the architect of these tree talks and all these renowned speakers we have had before, including Anjalendran, was because of her. So a big thank you to her. And a warm welcome to everybody. I can see 60 participants at the moment. So I will then introduce Ashira to make a tribute. Before that, just a reminder that after Anjalendran's presentation, there'll be question and answer time, as you see in the agenda. So please send in your questions through the chat box, which Aisha, who's doing the logistics for this meeting, will read out, and Anjalendran and anybody else can answer. Failing which, right at the end, I can also open the talk show to the participants who can speak to us and then ask any questions they deem fit. So the theme of the talk today is Colors of Barbara Sansoni. And the shirt I'm wearing, as I was telling Shirani and Anjalendran, was a Barbara Sansoni shirt bought more than 10 years ago. Still the colors are vibrant. So that probably has been a trademark of Barbara Sansoni product. So I won't dwell further, but I would now ask Ashira to make a tribute to her grandma. Ashira.
Thank you, Doshi and Sharanya, for organizing this. Really looking forward to Anjalendran's talk. I'll keep this short and sweet. My grandma, Barbara Sansoni, was a truly incredible woman. Very lucky I got to know her for the last 30 or so years. And I can honestly say she was someone who lived more in her one life than I think a lot of people would in five lifetimes. I think what I admired about her most was how sort of fearless she was, and she would really go after what she wanted, and she wouldn't let inconvenience or something stop her. She always found a way. She was a real good problem solver that way. I think back to all the stories I heard of when she started Barefoot and to what it's become now, and all the sort of the problems and the, or not problems, but you know, the, what word could I use? You know, it wasn't easy. We didn't have the ease of modern day luxuries of technology or transport to, you know, get things started. And she did an amazing sort of job. What was it like growing up with her? She was, of course, very creative. And I think that was something she tried to foster in all of us. She hated us watching too much television. I remember her telling my parents when we were young, they should only have a maximum of 1 hour of television a day. Of course, we broke that sometimes. She would always, every sort of Christmas and birthday, we'd be gifted with color pencils or drawing books or books of mythology or puzzles, things to really, she really wanted us to sort of work with our hands and our minds and not to sort of just be staring at a screen all day long. And I really appreciated that for her. Like, I think that tactileness, that physicality was really important, that creativity is really important. So I won't really go much longer, but what I wanted to do was read actually a couple of her poems, because in addition to being a designer and a colorist and an excellent illustrator, she also wrote, and she wrote poems. For every birthday, she would also draw and a cartoon sketch for her sons, her grandchildren, her cousins, and gift it to us. So I'll just read a couple. This one is titled Indian Ocean Isle. Are you a true islander? Do you keep your cool on the hottest airless day? Do you drench your view with the Mahaweli waters, Udarata, Blue Lagoon, Serendip, and water hyacinth? I loom these on warp to bring the outside in and hang a splash of river color in my city home. And the second poem that I will read is titled Jeffrey at Dinner with Chloe. Does pest control last? 33rd Lane, 33rd Lane. White ants and vermin are holding again. On the popular populace, all richly fabulous, inhabiting palaces, both subtle and vain, in 33rd Lane. Come weird men in masks, armed for the task of spraying and killing, sprinkling and drilling, the white and the black, ant, beetle, and rat, who ignore this behavior by hiding in India till toxic rains wane in 33rd Lane. Whereupon, emerging they leap upon, squeaking like Babel, chewing and gnawing, drinking and drawing, the very best vitamins from well-oiled citizens of 33rd Lane. 33rd Lane, 33rd Lane, has pest control then been in vain? Certainly not. Have you forgot the lady in housecoat and gown? Mrs. Pinto comes out with a shriek and a shout to waylay the mouse grown as large as a house. and white ants like gods she strike down with rods. Then gathering momentum, she whips them and smacks them, swats them and whacks them with a long fishy cane. Defeating the bane of 33rd lane once again and again and again. A long satisfied pause as coffee is served. Just a little fun fact as well. The iconic barefoot mouse, Grandma actually designed that because she was actually terrified of mice. And that was her way of trying to sort of get over her fear, was making it into this cute little toy, which, you know, she hoped it would help. And I think it did. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Asha. That was quite moving. And we got to know her background a little bit more. Before I request Shirani to introduce Anjalendran today, I heard that I hadn't had a moment of silence for your grandmother, Kalasuriya Bapra Sansoni. So can I please request all of us to keep a moment of silence in memory of Kalasuri Bapra Sansoni? A moment, please. Thank you. So we'll get on with our presentation, and Shirani, Professor Shirani Balasuriya, will introduce our speaker, Chartered Architect Anjalendran. And over to you, Shirani.
Thank you, Ashira, for that very lovely tribute. On behalf of Rukraya Gannu, I'm delighted and honored to introduce Architect C. Anjalendran, who is known to many as Anji. So, what are the takeaways regarding dear Anji? He represents the spirit of the rich vernacular tradition and is known across the Indian subcontinent for his unique style. He has been an academic for over four decades. History, experiencing architecture, landscape architecture, design has been his forte. His passion for art to all of us was very infectious. In fact, he had just returned from Rome. This has been his fifth visit. This morning, he was on a tour of the museum. And after this event, he goes to India to present his unique work. Perhaps his enthusiasm for traveling throughout the world, looking at architecture, garden, and art will continue when he's a centurion. He's well known for his innovative designs for the SOS villages, which he says Duppat architecture. To translate that, poor architecture, Duppat architecture, quoting Anji, where he was able to design sustainably, low cost, but it is so beautiful with an array of color, material, and textures. So, in summary, his work has been published as Anjalendran, Architect of Sri Lanka by David Robson. His work has also been presented by the Royal Institute of British Architects, and he has been honored with the Golden Award for Global Contribution to Architecture in New Delhi. Kalasuri Bapra Sansoni has not only been like a mother to him, but an inspiration and his color consultant. Thank you, Lilani, for suggesting his name to be our guest speaker to celebrate the life and work of Kalasuri Bapra Sansoni. So, Anji, the screen is yours. Colors of Bapra.
Thank you. Okay, I'd like to start by telling everybody or reminding everybody that Bapra Sansoni was a founder member of the Rukraya Gannu and founder life member of the Rukraya Gannu, and that's this connection to this exercise. This here she is with G.P. Malalasekara, the great Pali scholar, at her London exhibition in 1966. So I'm going to now start with a little video clip.
And at the Ceylon Tea Centre in London, there's an exhibition of her textiles and drawings, organised with the help of the Association of Ceylon Women in the United Kingdom. Its founder president is Mrs. Carcinada, who helps Mrs. Sansoni and her sister with the arrangement of the display, designed specifically to show the art and textiles of Ceylon to London shoppers. Mrs. Laile Malisakara, wife of the former High Commissioner for Ceylon in London, helps Covent Garden ballet dancer Michael Ingleton to hang some of the material before the visitors arrive. Mrs. Sansoni herself is there to greet them. British and American visitors are picturing these textiles against their own home background, but they're not allowed to forget that these are products of Ceylon. A display of Mrs. Sansoni's architectural drawings reminds them of the country for which she has done so much.
Okay, so I'll just start my presentation. Barbara Sansoni, it is actually called Color and Architectural Contribution of Barbara Sansoni Lewcock, because I think she did a lot for architecture also. Barbara Sansoni's interest in buildings had begun in her childhood through the high ceiling, wide veranda residences, which were occupied by her father as government agent in Batticaloa, Kurunagala, and Marthale. In her love affair with architecture crystallized in the early 60s, distributed by the destruction of the many beautiful buildings that were being knocked down or being remodeled in the name of progress, Barbara Sansoni decided that she would draw these old buildings in an endeavor to save them and for herself to enjoy. Her drawings initially appeared in a weekly series called Collecting Old Buildings in the Ceylon Daily Mirror in 1962 and 63. Some of these drawings accompanied the initial article on the joint work of Jeffrey Bauer and Ulrich Plesner in the Architectural Review of February 1966, with annotations by Ulrich Plesner and Dr. Ronald Lewcock, who later joined this effort in 1969. These drawings were published as a coffee table book called Viharas and Verandas in 1978, which was also reprinted in December 2007. With her patronage, seven of these architectural buildings and complex were measured by Ulrich Plesner, assisted by Ismat Rahim and Lucky Sennanayake. With 30 years of scholarship and dedication by Dr. Ronald Lewcock, these reached a total of 96 examples. This magnum opus was published as Architecture in Ireland in 1998 and has now become a source book. All these publications, which have no parallel, continue to make one aware of Sri Lanka's rich indigenous architectural traditions and heritage. Barbara also commissioned an annex for herself by architect Ulrich Plesner in 1962, who initially lived in it. With its spatial variations and minimal walls, under a simple gable roof, this was one of the forerunners of the resolved duality of tradition and the modern, and have continued to inspire generations of young architects, including myself. Barbara Sansoni joined in 1958 the famous Australian artist Donald Friend in drawing on unbaked clay tiles in Kalania. No doubt inspired by his drawings of every day, her drawings too contained the rich natural landscape to the buildings she drew. Note, these inspired the younger Lucky Sennanayake and Ismat Rahim, both with botanical inclinations, to draw the natural settings as an integral part of the architectural drawings. These have now become internationally accepted as the Jeffrey Bauer style of architectural drawing, which has subsequently influenced the Asian and South Asian architectural world. So what I'm actually telling is this whole notion of embodying realistic plants in architectural drawings begins with Donald Friend, Barbara Sansoni, then with Ulrich and Lucky, and now it is considered the Jeffrey Bauer lingua franca of drawing, okay? So she should, and Barbara, you can see all these are identifiable trees, which is, I think, her real connection to the Rookcracker Garden. Jeffrey Barber and Ulrich Plesner also designed the Chapel of the Good Shepherd in Bandaravali in 1963. For this remarkable chapel, Barbara Sansoni worked with terracotta tiles, used this technique to do the 14 stations of the cross. And these are cruciform, the three cruciform mullions leading to the altar. She also did the palm of the Good Shepherd in these recessed arches. And the risen Christ was done in clay and reproduced in concrete, okay? And I have traveled the world. I think that this chapel is one of the most amazing pieces of architecture because it involved Jeffrey Barber, Ulrich Plesner, Barbara Sansoni, and Lucky Cinemaker, who did the vestments, inspired by Matisse. Barbara Sansoni also drew designs of animals, birds, and creepers in the St. Bridget's Montessori staircases designed by Bava in 1961. Her interest in architecture has been essayed in numerous articles. These include some notes on the old furniture. These are all Dutch furniture, which people wanted to be modern. And, you know, I mean, she was trying to revive an understanding of her rich traditions. Leela's Road, who starts with traditional buildings and end up in the factories at Ekala. An essay of a city son of Colombo. The background is Jeffrey Barber in the Mima Monograph Concept Media Singapore and the Sri Lankan Vernacular for Architecture and Design India in March, April, 1990. And it goes on to her particular view of barefoot design, which was her notion of things. So Mother Provincial of Good Shepherd Nuns had created weaving centers for disadvantaged women who had no schooling to learn skills. She requested Barbara Sansoni to help out with colors. This successful exercise called Barefoot, a household named in Sri Lanka, was inspired the lifestyle of the weavers. Barefoot is now a cottage industry involving over 600 weavers. As Barbara says, buy new colors to clash with the walls, then stop to match is mediocre to clash divine. So these are not Western relationships of color. This is her own understanding of looking at color for the tropics, okay? So she went on, her warp and weft of color make cotton often look like silk. You know, here you look, it looks like silk. Furthermore, the designers of Barefoot have managed to capture moods, flora and fauna and landscape into two-dimensional cloth, as demonstrated in an exhibition catalog called How Can It Be So Right Yet, Sarong, of December 2004. So this is that, you know, color and 40 years. You can see that this is a squirrel fish made into two-dimensional cloth. So this is the painted stalk made into two-dimensional cloth. So this is not, you know, structured color, which is often what happens in India and by interior designers. This is colors because they are taken, inspired by nature, which can fit into the human world and doesn't look out of place. So this is the temple shrine room doors, okay? And her work, and these are various things. This is the peacock in Yala. This is desert bones. This is a cat. And this is evening, sunset. So her work appears in Kandalama. And these are, she actually trained a team of designers because she wanted to perpetuate her way of thinking, okay? So here she also painted several buildings. In 1989, the SOS Youth Village situated in Piliandala, of which the portals changed from ultramarine to neon green, okay? Tied together by bright yellow sunlight beam. There are courtyards in things of red, orange, and yellow. It's a very dynamic, there's an ordinary shed-like building, now becoming a dynamic, passionate thing. simply because of the use of color. Now you can see here, the building expands in this direction, contracts in this direction. That's when you begin to understand that she really knew color. You must know that all Western theorists of color have never been able to demonstrate their understanding of color in real time. In my opinion, who has been able to do that has been Dr. Sansoni. Colors lead one through these buildings, and the interaction of these hues make directional movement to these buildings a much varied exhibition experience. Jeffrey Bawat thoroughly enjoyed this building to his merriment. I mean, he said, Anjalendran, go, go, go away. And he laughed and laughed and laughed in his wheelchair. So it would be brutal to say that most other international theorists of color have not been able to demonstrate their understanding of color except intuitively. Barbara's interaction of color, which is a borrowed term from Joseph Albers, which has led to her unique understanding of color, particularly of light and shade. The successful experiments of coloring three-dimensional buildings have helped her rediscover own architectural drawings and present them in color to show various ways of seeing color. So you can see this is a house in Bhattaramulla. She said all these rafters are palu, have the opposite side of the color view, and this palu has blues and oranges. And if you brought the blue in, you brought the sky in, and three beams became sunlight. And the garden was brought into the house to expand the garden by turbines. And that is the reality, okay? This was built for a Dutch lady, a husband who was a Sri Lankan. She was inspired by De Hoek, who's also Dutch. And she did, the structure is clarified by color, right? And that is the maquette, and that is the reality. And so you can see here a De Hoek drawing where you can see the yellows advance, light advances, the grays recede. And it is that understanding that Barbara uses in her, she observes and then she can come out and do a thing like this. It's not accidental. It's not what my mother said or the teacher said. It is done with a real understanding of what color is all about. So you can see here, these reds advance, these greens recede. So the courtyard becomes smaller. So here you can see this, I'll show you another picture where these recede and the back building advances. So here these advance and this building recedes. This is a building in Nigambo. This is a painting called The Windows of Vatiklo. And then Barbara went on to do Misifu and Tikiri Banda, about two frolics of two neighboring cats, followed by Misifu in Yala. She also published a book, poetry book, Pressed with Toes in the Grass in December 2003. In 2004, How Can You Be So Right Yet, Sarong? Rahul Jacob's quotation, celebrating 40 years of design, color, and weaving, linking us with the worldwide modern movement of the 20th century. It was published to accompany an exhibition at Barefoot. A Passion for Faces was published in 2014, showing the unitary structure of the face across the maritime silk route in spite of color. What Barbara says, if you remove the color from the face, there are unusual things happening. And some of the, that's a book of poetry. And this is how she starts painting in color for own drawings and so on. So Barbara Sansoni was featured in Pathways to the Peak, Remarkable Stories from Pioneering Sri Lankan Women in 2011. Also in the inaugural issue of Domus B2, options October-November 2014. Barbara Sansoni received a Lifetime Award from the Jeffrey Bawat Trust in July 2011 for her architectural contribution of pioneering revival and design in the field of handlooms, as well as a unique perception of a Sri Lankan identity of color. Barbara was one of the celebrated in the Business Today Passion 2017 in October. In June, July 2021, which was last year, the Artha magazine paid a tribute by bringing out an issue of Barbara Sansoni. Barbara Sansoni was a multifaceted personality. She was not only was an artist with an exceptional and unique understanding of color, but more so a storyteller with a humor. Also, most importantly, her love of everyday architecture, which she has recorded for her motherland, is a significant contribution. It is an appreciation of what's good and simple. I would also add, not pompous, because that is what architecture is deemed to be today. Art is not life, but it is a part of life. Architecture of how we live is an integral part of our lives, preferably without pretense. This is what I've learned from Barbara Sansoni, as well as Jeffrey Bava, Ina De Silva, and Lucky Senanayake, all who have contributed to Sri Lanka, who have all enriched my life and that of those of Sri Lanka. I'm ending up with Barbara talking about her own views of color at the end of her life.
I painted all my life. Didn't paint much in school. I went to a convent boarding school and they didn't allow colours. But they sent me to be treated by Maria Montessori. You know, she's a great individualist. I couldn't count. I couldn't do sums or anything else. So I was sent to her, and she said, well, I'll teach you with stones. And she said, you just carry the stones in your purse and do it. So I did for years do that. I did carry stones. I carried nuts. Then when she found that I liked drawing best of all, she said, don't you ever stop drawing. Because people who paint and draw, and people who cook are the most intelligent people in the world. So from that day, I continued to draw and to colour, even if it was under the desk, and she had given me the courage to do it. She said, if you're doing examinations, was the nun said, you can't draw when you have examinations, Barbara. I had been sent to art school and I was hopeless at life drawing. You know, they were sort of silly things, life drawings. And I think now it was a stupid thing to have somebody sitting and you have to draw them or somebody standing in a pose. You drew them, I think they were silly, that's not what drawing figures are about, they move. I thought, well, as I can't draw figures as well as I would like them to be, I draw faces. And of course, once I started, I couldn't stop because there's so many different kinds of faces. And then I began to ask people where they came from, which I never would have done before, I never thought of it. I noticed that faces had nothing to do with the colour. That discovery was so intriguing that I couldn't stop drawing. I wanted to make a record of it. There was a time when I was very bored. I was in Ceylon and I was going around a lot. And then I thought, there must be some way of not being bored. So I drew. The things I enjoyed most, I went to Jaffna, and I noticed the Jaffna people built their houses in a very definite way, very clear style. I did the houses in Jaffna first. Then I was obsessed, I couldn't stop. I drew everything I saw. And the one that was the most difficult was when I saw a fortress. And of course, a fortress in that sort of place was just one long line horizontally, and the fortress was within it. That was a bit difficult. So I think, like most things, they become an obsession. I draw first, and I colour it when I go. I often have done those long after I did the drawing. It's going to be something I can't remember. I make a little note on the side of what the colours are.
Thank you, Anjalendran. Is that all?
That's all. I'm finished.
Stories to tell us.
I just want to thank Rukraka Gano for giving me this great opportunity to talk about my favorite people I've ever known in my life.
Thank you very much. We need to thank you in turn, and thank Shirani for proposing that you do this presentation. We got a real mesmerizing peek into a path with vibrant colors and a lifestyle. So the next item is question and answers. Maybe I will start with a question of my own to you, Anjalendran. So Barbara was an artist, an architect, and a poet, an entrepreneur, among many other things. What was she first? Was she a combination of all?
No, she was actually a simple housewife. I mean, she was asked by Mother Good Counsel to teach poor women color to enhance their weaving techniques. She was not an architect, but she would appreciate architecture, right? I mean, in all these things, you know, everyone says people went out to be so and such a things. Most of our lives, and I would say, I mean, I would put people like Barbara Sansoni, Ina De Silva, Jeffrey Bava, Lucky Senanak, and all, set out to do anything. They never set out to do anything. I have this little quotation by Donald Friend, which is also one of my favorites. I said, like all young men, I set out to be a genius, but laughter mercifully intervened. That is, they all knew how to laugh. That is the main thing, right? And to enjoy life. And because they did that, they could also do help with the other things and share that laughter. Anything else?
Yes, I will now ask Aisha if there are any questions from the participants, or if the participants wants to speak through the webinar, we can allow them to do so if you raise a hand in the chat.
Yes, we have two raised hands at the moment, Dushi, from Ninel Fernando and Priya Worm.
Okay, Ninel first then.
Okay. Ninel, you are able to speak if you wish. You can unmute, and you can, if you have a question, you can raise your question.
But can't see.
Ninel, I think you are currently muted. I'm not sure whether you raised your hand by accident.
Okay, we'll get on to the other.
I think that one, Priya had pressed the wrong button, so she wasn't there.
Okay.
She wasn't, yeah, she raised the hand by accident. Simon has a comment. He says, Barbara Sansoni's drawing style was very distinctive, always recognizable. From the film, we learned that her education was limited. Who do you feel were her main influences?
I mean, I think she's a creative woman and she found her own way. I mean, I don't think anybody taught her. I mean, she did go to art school, but she had to find her. I mean, she's unique because her drawings and all are unique. It's not inspired directly by anything. She must have learned. She did go to art school, but mainly she learned as she went. And that is what all creative people do. You know, I mean, I don't think anybody can copy, and I don't think she copied anybody else. She was inspired. I can actually identify things, but she was her own inspiration. And I think most creative people are.
Tirani, do you have any questions before I ask Anjalendran and another?
There was a message from Dominique Sansoni onto my cell phone, and he says, that was so beautiful, really lovely. So that's a comment
Thank
from
you.
Dominique.
Yeah.
Family can't make comments like that anyway.
We also have another raised hand from Nisha Fernando. Nisha, I've unmuted you, so you can feel free to speak.
I'm sure. Thank you. Can you all hear me?
Yes,
but
we
like
can.
I'd like to see you.
Yeah. Can we put
yeah.
video
I
on?
I think all the videos are turned off, Mr. Anjalendran. Mr. Anjalendran, thank you so much. I was your student, also Mr. and Mrs. Balasuriya, way back in late 80s. You don't remember me, so don't worry.
You're telling how old we are, you know.
No, you all were my gurus. So thank you. It was so good to see your faces. I'm in the US, so I'm joining from the US right now.
Thank you very much.
My question is, it was a wonderful presentation, so thank you so much. And as actually when you taught us, you brought us to Barbara. And Barbara gave us a series of lectures and shouted us at us for wearing really muddy looking clothes without color. I still remember that. She was a fantastic personality and a great influence. So with that, I would like to know what kind of steps are taken to continue her legacy, either through barefoot or in any other manner.
Well, one of the slides I showed was the designers of barefoot trained by Barbara Sansoni more than 20, 30 years thing. And so we hope, I mean, unlike a lot of people like Jeffrey Bava and Ina De Silva's tradition is being continued. The Aluihara workshop is run by Amila DeMille and her student helper, Jonathan. Like that, Dominique Sansoni is continuing the legacy. But you must know that these are in difficult times, these are difficult things. I think Dominique Sansoni is a close friend of mine, but I hope they have the belief and the cash in these difficult times to continue. Because, you know, I mean, what I see in Sri Lanka is absolute madness. And if we are not positive, if for me, as a creative person, what I would do is not be negative. I will do something positive. And that is the only way I would contribute to my country. I think that is what Dominic is also doing. But of course, as I said, he's responsible for 600 people, and feeding 600 people is not an easy thing, you know, because there are other logistical issues. Simply, it's a cottage industry. And in today, particularly now in the last few months, to have a cottage industry with 600 people is a nightmare. You know, so I wish him best, and I hope people will give patronage to barefoot, because like who Dushi said, his shirt has lasted 10 years. Most other shirts last 2 years because the quality of fabric and the dyes are very, very, they don't stint on that. That is a difference between a good designer and a bad designer, okay? Or a good weaver and a bad weaver. Does that answer your question?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, it's wonderful to know that. And, you know, even though I live away from Sri Lanka, I'm still very Sri Lankan at heart. So this is wonderful. So thank you. And
thank you.
Really good to know that I know Dominique Sansoni continues the work, but just wanted to know the extent of it.
Dominic is continuing. I mean, the great for me, I mean, you know, I knew Barbara Sansoni very well. I then very, very much later got to know Ina, and she said, oh, I hear there's another woman in your life. So I'm very glad to say that a younger generation has, even Dominic's children, now Ashira is actually helping at barefoot. So it's nice to see a very much younger generation is continuing these crafts. I don't know how long it'll last, because continuing traditions take a lot of effort. The one doesn't realize it. So I know that at the moment, the, you know, these little fabrics are also, there's a continuity, And definitely, there's an organizational continuity at Barefoot, except now Dominic will get upset with me saying, but some of them are quite old. I mean, Barbara Sansoni started this in 1950s or 60s. You know, now we are right. 70 years down the line. And 70 years down the line is that Dominic is also probably 60 years old. You know? So it means that he should get another generation. And I must say that now, recently, Amila said, Anjalan, you mustn't hog everything. You must allow a younger generation to continue. And I think that's absolutely, I have no problem with that whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very true. Very
and I true. Wish you all the best. I wish I could see your face, but never mind.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Anjalendran. I wish it's okay too, but I just want to, you know, for me to see you and Mr. and Mrs. Balasuriya, because you are all my teachers. And, you know, I'm, you know, in my mid-50s or late-50s right now. So it's so good to see, or you know, I wouldn't say the word old, but former teachers.
Old. No,
it was really nice. And, you know, I last time I was in Sri Lanka a couple of years ago, I brought back a whole suitcase book of books from Barefoot. I probably pretty much bought everything that was there.
Well, you so can't buy any more books in Barefoot because they've become 10 times the price they were.
Oh.
Paper has become very expensive, so everything has gone up in price. You know, anyway, never
this
mind.
This was luckily a few years ago, a couple of years ago. So
I'm sure, yeah. Not a couple of years ago, 3 months ago, it was cheap.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I hope everything will come back to normalcy very soon.
I hope so too. That is the best prayer you can give. That is the best prayer you can give Sri Lanka. And be positive. And you can help, help. Don't criticize. One of the things I don't like is people criticizing Sri Lanka. It's where I've chosen to live, despite all negativeness. And I will try and contribute positively too. Okay.
I think thank you so much, Nisha. Yes, I think that's a good segue into the next question. So we have Satimanta Malalasekara, who has asked, can you explain more about how Barbara's work and legacy is continuing now?
Look, I've answered that.
I have answered just answered it.
Mention that.
You
might
know that Dominic, I don't know, I'm one of Dominic's closest, I would think that Dominic is one of my closest friends. And I feel sorry for him, the burden of looking, funding 600 people, you know, I mean, you know, it's not an easy task. He's morning to night texting because there are several problems in the day. But, well, I will also be open. I mean, I know the family law. I would really wish at least some of his children would continue the tradition. Okay. But you can't. I don't think I would also then say, I don't think it's fair to impose. So that is something that he'll have to work out. I mean, I don't get any headaches. Okay. Anything else?
Also, we have Sebastian Sansoni who has asked.
Okay.
Who has asked, can a person like Barbara exist in Sri Lanka today? And if not, what about that time made her and her contributions so unique?
Oh, because it was in a time, I mean, very simple. How did people like Barbara happen? Now, everyone looks at this negatively. Mrs. Bandaranaike came into power. She stopped imports and she stopped people traveling abroad. I mean, we had a blossom of creativity. Barbara did amazing drawings on brown paper, but the paper couldn't be bought. That was towards the 1960s. You couldn't get cloth. So this weaving had to be cloth had to not come from Egypt, it had to come from India and Pakistan, right? You got Jeffrey doing things like the Ina de Silva house and the annex I showed her, Ina de Silva doing batiks. So those were economic circumstances. That is to say that when, when there are circumstances which force people to be creative, then creative people become creative. And those are the circumstances that made your grandmother possible. It didn't make me, I was born after that, thank God. But it is that I mean, why is Jeffrey's work known? Because it grew out of a lack of things. And he had to use a tradition to inspire and build, because there was only a few materials available. You know, there were no large panes of glass and all available at that time. So, you know, sort of positive way, Mrs. Bandarnag is ridiculous. I would even say your economic reforms contributed to the creative of the country.
Right, right.
Does that answer your question, Sebastian?
He has asked it on the Q&A, so we might see his response on the chat. Before then, let's jump into another question from Hiranti, who asks, to what extent has Barbara Sansoni influenced and inspired you?
You know, no, it's not only Barbara. I mean, I must say that all these people, you must know that, I mean, I knew Jeffrey Bawa very well, but nobody ever heard me speak in front of Jeffrey Bawa. I mean, I spoke to Jeffrey, I entertained other people with him. So there was a certain formality, and that formality was less. The people who broke those formalities were Lucky, Ina, and Barbara. I mean, they were not that formal. With Jeffrey, there were very clear rules about what you can and can't do, implicit, right? So I think that all these people have made me who I am. It's not one person, because with this one person, I'll be doing what they did. Because I was influenced by this whole range of people, I am Anjalendran. That's what everyone wants to know, whether I'm doing Jeffrey Bawa. I'm not. I'm doing Anjalendran architecture. With the knowledge of Jeffrey Bawa, Ina, Barbara, and Lucky, all whom I got to know firsthand. And doing work relationships, you know, like Barbara's work, she had measured drawing she had collected for 30 years. It took us 5 years to put together, you know. And we lost slides, got the slides back, put it together with him. Nobody published it. Then we decided to publish it ourselves, you know. Now, by the time I did my book 20 years later, there was nobody doing hand drawings. So the publisher came to me and said, can we do your book? You know, so you must know that Sri Lanka has gone through very difficult times. And all these people are being creative because of their difficult times. It's very easy to say, you know, if you have dollars and euros and all, you have a better lifestyle, whatever it is. I don't think I've gone through the world. And I don't think a lot of that architecture comes to the comfort and joy of ours. I mean, there's a lot of pretense in those things. You know? And as I said, one of the things that Barbara hated, Ina and Jeffrey in his own silent way, is pretentiousness. You know, architecture is today taught as a pretentious thing. Right? For these people, pretension didn't matter. It wasn't irrelevant. It wasn't relevant. Okay? Is there anything else? I'm being bad.
Yes. No. So on that note, Shireen Amendra has asked, hello, Anji, do you think formal qualifications stifle spontaneous creativity? Thank you for a wonderful presentation.
Okay, Shirani.
Shireen.
Shireen. I mean, she was 1 year senior to me in school. It is like this. I mean, like Jeffrey would say, if you go through a degree, your mind is trained in a different way. But you would say that Barbara, to do weaving, she had no training. And Lucky, he failed in art. In school, you know, I think he's one of the greatest painters in Sri Lanka.
So, he worked with
who?
Jeffrey Bawa.
No, but those are after he failed art in school. No, but Lucky only became an artist at, he actually also worked for Valentine, who never did any of these things. Valentine left, he stayed on with Jeffrey and Ulrich, right? And he learned, as I said, they knew Donald Friend, they knew Barbara Sansoni. They couldn't get to know Donald Friend and Barbara Sansoni. Donald Friend is an internationally known artist. But they learned how to get inspired and do their own unique thing in whatever they were interested in. Even Lucky is not a single personality, he's a multifaceted personality. You know, he did his own architecture, he never learned architecture, right? And even Ina and all did their own style of batik. It isn't Indonesian batik, it is uniquely hers. And even Barbara's, as I told you, what is unique about, I mean, what is amazing about her, is that she created her own style of color in cloth. And as she went, she experimented and she was happy to do things, you know. I mean, now, for example, there's this great story which I told all over again, that when Jeffrey was, when Ina asked Jeffrey what colors I should use, Jeffrey said, Ina, you can use any color you like as long as it is black, white, or gray. So she became Jeffrey's colorist. But when I asked, and I was a brat, I mean, you must know that Barbara is probably, she was, okay, 94, I'm 24 years younger than her. But when I said, Barbara, can you color this building? She said, yes, darling, I'll come and color it. So, but that is what means experimenting and exploration in architecture and color and all that. You know, it's not reading a book on color or something like that. That is not what it is all about. So I think that the thing we should emphasize is that we always think, and I think at fault, that creativity is something that is Western oriented. And I always tell, now this morning I was asked, I gave a lecture of a tour of the museum. And one of the things that fascinate me, you know, everyone says, you know, single is landscape, the buildings relate to the landscape relates to architecture. I say, no, in Sinhalese architecture, the architecture and the buildings are integral to one another, which is a completely different way. Now, in no European architecture, they're always relating to each other. That's why we also think it's essential to relate. But if you look at Sinhalese architecture, and I would say as a Tamil, in Tamil architecture, it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen in Muslim architecture. It happens in European. And the only place where it actually happens, begins to happen, where the building is an integral part of the landscape, is in things like Lunukang, done by Jeffrey, which is absolutely, there's nothing accidental. But my favorite example will be Kaluya Pokuna, which I've got in my book, and Sasebo. I find this Sinhalese, I mean, of course, I would also, now like today I said, I don't know who got upset, but the Sinhalese have lost it somewhere. Because the main thing in architecture now is to follow the West. I mean, there's another, the guy who won the Pritzker Prize this year called Francis Carey. Absolutely amazing architecture. But by the time it comes to Sri Lanka, I don't know where we have gone, but anyway, that's somewhere else. I think that the thing to understand is that we have very high standards from the past to the present. It's just that we don't know ourselves. We only know what happens in America or England or Europe. I've just come from Italy, seeing some of the best architecture you can ever see. So I'm not ignorant of the world. But I also know that what we have in Sri Lanka, like Barbara Sansoni Annex and all that, they are second to none in the rest of the world. You know, these are, but we don't know that. Because we don't talk of our own, I mean, Sri Lankans are only good at downing ourselves. Not saying this is what we should celebrate. That's why I'm very happy about Rukraka Guhano in the past. Because this is about celebration, a person's life. And that thank is you. Important.
Yeah. Yes, thank you very much. Aisha, any more questions?
We have that question from Ninel Fernando, who had raised their hand previously. They put the question on the chat, which is that Lucky Ina were maybe enriched by their connection with Cora Abraham. Did Barbara also interact with Cora? No.
Dominique went to Cora Abraham, not Barbara.
Okay.
She went to Manipal. I mean, she went to a place in Ode Canal in India, and she did art. But what the art she was taught is not the art she ended up doing, because she didn't agree with it. But she was trained. that Dominic is saying to all panelists. What is she saying? He's saying.
Shall we put Dominic online and let him speak? Aisha.
He is a panelist already.
Yeah, so Dominic, you like to say something?
He said that his speaker wasn't working.
Okay. Any more questions, Aisha?
We do have a comment from Nisha. She says, this is just a comment or observation. I feel that after the generations of Jeffrey, Barbara, Lucky, Ina, etc., and of course, including you, Mr. Anjalendran, there seems to be a void of the same Sri Lankan fervor among architects, artists, and creators, sadly. Would you agree?
No, it's not my place to agree. You know, all I can say is I would say I was lucky to live a life which enriched mine. If it didn't enrich mine, I couldn't have done what I'm doing. So I never say what other people should do. You know, I also know, as I said, I have enjoyed what I'm doing. Also, it comes from all these people I hero worship. I do hero worship. But it's just that today people want a shortcut to knowledge and happiness. I don't think there's such a thing, actually.
All right. I think with that, we've covered all the questions. So we can move on to the next segment. Back to you, Dushi.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Jalendran. And some fantastic questions and answers. I was mesmerized by the slideshow for a start. And also to say that Barbara was certainly ahead of time when way back in the late 60s, she had these vibrant colors and obviously thought outside the box, so to speak. So what's the next item on the agenda? Is it vote of thanks? Or,
yes, it is.
Right. So we have gone for more than 1 hour, 10 minutes, Anjalendran. So before we end, we will have the vote of thanks given by Aisha, who is doing the logistics herself. And to all the participants, a very big thank you. After the vote of thanks, please, if you didn't watch the slideshow which we showed at the start, please remain and watch the slideshow. Thank you very much, and over to you, Aisha.
Thank you, Dushi. So first of all, of course, we would like to express a very warm thank you to Anjalendra, who has taken a lot of time from his busy schedule to share his very insightful appreciation of the wonderful Barbara Sansoni, who, as he said, was like a mother to him. So thank you very much, Anjalendra, for your delightful presentation. Also, we really appreciate the sentiments of Ashira Sansoni, whose words about and by her beloved grandmother as well touched our hearts. I myself have gotten one of your grandmother's mice toys as a child, so it was a real pleasure to hear about how they came to be. We would also like to thank the Jeffrey Baba Trust and Shayari De Silva, who never hesitate to support us in conducting these online events. And of course, today would not have been possible without the hard work of the Rukraka Gannu Committee, led by Dushi and Shirani, both of whom work passionately to make these events possible. Thank you also to Erandi, who designs delightful posters for all these events, Jalami, who keeps everybody in the loop, and Lilani, who had the initial idea for today's program. And finally, we would like to thank all of you who are here today for being a wonderful and an engaged audience. We really value your enthusiasm and your participation, and we hope to see you again at the next Rukraka Gannu event. Thank you, and back to you, Dushi.
Thank you very much, Aisha, and a big thank you once again. So enjoy the slideshow which Aisha will put on now. And if you are not a member of Rukraka Gannu, at the end, we will also show out our application form. So or send us an email and please join us in our endeavors of protecting the environment. And like Rukraka Gannu in Sinhalese, preservation of the trees. Thank you very much, and a big good night from me. Thank you, Ayesha.